Now, fair Hippolyta, our nuptial hour draws on apace. Four happy days bring in another moon. But oh, methinks how slow this old moon wanes. She lingers my desires like to a stepdame or a dowager, long withering out a young man's revenue.
4 days will quickly suit themselves a night. 4 nights will quickly dream away the time, and then the moon, like to a silver bow new bent in heaven, shall behold the night of our solemnity.
Hippolyta, I wooed thee with my sword and won thy love, doing thee injury. But I will wed thee in another key, with hope, with triumph, and with reveling.
Hail Theseus, our renowned Duke.
Thanks, good Aegeus. What's the news with thee?
Full of vexation come I with complaint against my child, against my daughter Hermia. Stand forth, Demetrius. My lord, this man hath consent to marry her. Stand forth, Lysander, my gracious Duke. This man hath bewitched the bosom of my child. Thou, Lysander, thou hast given her rhymes and interchanged love tokens with my child. Thou hast by moonlight at her window sung with feigning voice verses of feigning love and stolen the impression of her fantasy. With cunning, thou hast filched her heart, taken her obedience, which is due me, and turned it unto stubborn harshness. And my gracious Duke, be it so, that she will not consent to come before you and marry Demetrius. I beg the ancient privilege of Athens. If she is mine, I may dispose of her, which shall be to this gentleman or to her death, according to the law immediately provided in that case.
What say you, Hermia? Be advised, fair maid, to you your father should be as a god, one that composed your beauties, yea, and one to whom you are but as a form in wax, by him imprinted, and within his power to leave the figure or disfigure it. Demetrius is a worthy gentleman.
Who is Lysander?
In himself he is, but in this kind, wanting your father's voice, the other must be held the worthier.
I would my father looked but with my eyes.
Rather, your eyes must with his judgment look.
I do entreat your grace to pardon me. I know not by what power I am made bold, but I beseech your grace that I may know the worst that may befall me in this case if I refuse to wed Demetrius.
Either to die the death, or to abjure forever the society of men. Therefore, fair Hermia, question your desires. Know of your youth, examine well your blood, whether if you yield not to your father's choice, you can endure the livery of a nun, chanting faint hymns to the cold, fruitless moon. And thrice blessed they that master so their blood to undergo such maiden pilgrimage. But earthlier happy is the rose distilled than that which withering on the virgin thorn grows, lives, and dies in single blessedness.
So will I grow, so live, so die, my lord, ere I will yield my virgin patent up.
Take time to pause, and by the next new moon, the sealing day betwixt my love and me for everlasting bond of fellowship, upon that day either prepare to die for disobedience to your father's will, or else to wed Demetrius as he would, or on Diana's altar to protest for high austerity and single life.
Relent, sweet Hermia, and Lysander, yield that crazed title to my certain right.
You have her father's blood, Demetrius. Let me have Hermia's. Do you marry him?
Scornful Lysander. True, he hath my love. And what is mine, my love may render him, and she is mine. All right of her, I do estate unto Demetrius.
I am, my lord, as well derived as he. As well possessed, my love is more than his. My fortune's every way is fairly ranked, if not with vantage as Demetrius is. And which is more than all these boasts can be, I have beloved obedient Hermia. Why should not I then prosecute my right? Demetrius, all avouch it to his head, made love to Nestor's daughter Helena, and won her soul, and she, sweet lady, dotes, devoutly dotes. Don't deny idolatry upon this body, then, inconstant man!
I must confess that I have heard so much, and with Demetrius thought to have spoke thereof. But, being over full of self-affairs, my mind did lose it. But, Demetrius, come, and come, Aegeus, you shall go with me. I have some private schooling for you both. And for you, fair Hermia, look you arm yourself to fit your fancies to your father's will, or else the law of Athens yields you up, which by no means we may extenuate, to death or to a vow of single life. Come, Hippolyta, what cheer, my love? Demetrius and Aegeus, go along. I must employ you in some business against our nuptial, and confer with you of something nearly that concerns yourselves.
With duty and desire, we follow.
How now, my love? Why is your cheek so pale? How chance the roses there to face so fast?
He lies for want of rain, which I could well beteem them from the tempest of my eyes.
Ah, me. Not that I could ever read, could ever hear by teller history. The course of true love never did run smooth. But either it was different in blood.
Oh, cross, too high to be enthralled to low.
Or else misrapid in respect of years.
Oh, spite, too old to be engaged to young.
Or else it's set upon the choice of friends.
Oh, hell, to choose love by another's eyes.
Hear me, Hermia. I have a widow aunt, a dowager of great revenue, and she hath no child. From Athens is her home, remote 7 leagues, and she respects me as her only son. There, gentle Hermia, may I marry thee. And to that place the sharp Athenian law cannot pursue us. If thou lovest me then, go forth thy father's house tomorrow night, and in the wood a league without the town, where I did meet thee once with Helena, to do observance to a morn of May, there I will stay for thee.
My good Lysander, I swear to thee, by Cupid's strongest bow, by his best arrow with the golden head, by the simplicity of Venus' dove, by that which knitteth souls and prosperous love, by all the vows that ever men have broke, in numbers more than ever woman spoke, in that same place thou hast appointed me, tomorrow truly will I meet with thee.
He promised, love. Look, here comes Helena.
Cut speed, fair Helena, whither away? Call you me fair? That fair again, unsay. Demetrius loves your fair. Oh, happy fair. Your eyes are lodestars, and your tongue sweet air, more tunable than larch, the shepherd's ear, will weed is green, when hawthorn buds a pair. Sickness is catching. Oh, our favor, so yours would I catch, fair Hermia, ere I go. My ear should catch your voice, my eye, your eye, my tongue should catch your tongue's sweet melody. Were the world mine, Demetrius being sated, the rest I'd give to be to you translated. Oh, teach me how you look, and what art you sway the motion of Demetrius' heart. I frown upon him, yet he loves me still. Oh, that your frown could teach my smile such skill. I give him curses, yet he gives me love. Oh, that my prayers could such affection move. The more I hate, the more he follows me. The more I love, the more he hateth me. His folly, Helena, is no fault of mine. Not but your beauty, would that fault were mine. Take comfort. He no more shows me my face. Lysander and myself still thrive this place.
Helen, to your mind we will unfold. Tomorrow night when Phoebe doth behold her silver visage in the watery glass, decking with liquid pearl the bladed grass, a time when lover's flight doth feel concealed. Through Athens gates we have devised the seal.
And in the wood where often you and I, upon fate's primrose bed, will want to lie, emptying our bosoms of their counsel sweet, there my Lysander and myself shall meet. And thence from Athens turn away our eyes to seek new friends and stranger companies. Farewell, sweet playfellow, pray for us, and good luck grant thee thy Demetrius. Be words, Lysander, we must starve our sight from lover's food till morrow deep midnight.
Will my hurt? Helen, I do. As you dote on him, Demetrius dotes on you.
How happy some or other some can be! Through Athens, I thought as fair as she. But what of that? Demetrius thinks not so. He will not know what all but he do know. And as he errs doting on Hermia's eyes, I, admiring of his quality. Things base and vile, holding no quantity. Love can transpose to form and dignity. Love looks not with the eye, but with the mind. And therefore his wing is Cupid painted blind. Nor hath love mind of any touch or taste. Wings and no eyes figure unheeding hate. And therefore is love said to be a child, because in choice he is so oft beguiled. As waggish boys and gay themselves forswear, so the boy love is perjured everywhere. For ere Demetrius looked on Hermia thine, he held out oath that he were only mine. And when some heat this hail from Hermia fell, so he dissolved, the showers of oath did melt. I will go tell him of fair Hermia's flight. Then to the wood will he tomorrow night pursue her. For this intelligence, if I have thanks, it is a dear expense. But herein mean I to enrich my pain, to have his sight thither and back again.
Is all our company here?
Oh. You were best to call them generally, man by man, according to the script.
Yes. Here is the scroll of every man's name, which is thought fit for all Athens. They and our interlude before the Duke and Duchess on his wedding day at night.
And first, good Peter Quince, say what the play treats on. Then read the names of the actors, and so grow to a point.
Mary, our play is the most lamentable comedy and the most cruel death of Pyramus and Thisbe.
A very good piece of work, I assure you. And now, good Peter Quince, call forth your actors by the scroll. Masters, spread yourselves.
Actor, I call you, Nick Bottom the Weaver.
Ready. Name what part I am born, proceed.
You, Nick Bottom, are set down for Pyramus.
What is Pyramus? A lover or a tyrant?
A lover that kills himself most gallantly for love.
That will ask some tears in the true performing of it, if I do it. Let the audience look to their eyes. I will move stones. I will condole in some measure. Yet to the rest. My chief humor is war tyrant. I could play Hercules rarely.
The raging rocks and shivering sharks shall break the locks of prison gates. And Phoebus' car shall shine from far and make and mar the foolish face.
This was lofty. Now name the rest of the players. This is Heracles' vein, a tyrant's vein. A lover is more condoling.
Francis Flute, the bellows mender.
Here, Peter Quince.
Flute, you must take Thisbe on you.
What is Thisbe, a wandering knight?
It is the lady that Pyramus must love.
Faith, let me not play woman, I have a beard coming.
And so one! You shall play it in a mask, and you may speak it more if you will.
Then I may hide my face, let me play Thisbe too. I'll speak in a monstrous little voice. Thisbe, Thisbe!
Ah, Pyramus, my lover dear, thy Thisbe dear, lady dear!
No, no, you must play Pyramus, and Flute, you Thisbe.
Well, proceed.
Robin Starling, the tailor.
Here, Peter Quince.
Robin Starling, you must play Thisbe's mother. John Snell, the tailor.
Here, Peter Quince.
You, Pyramus's father.
Myself, Thisbe's father.
John Conjoiner,
you've a lion's part. And I hope here is a play fitted.
Have you the lion's part written? Pray you, if it be, give it me, for I am slow of study.
And let me play the lion, too! I will roar, and I will do any man's heart good to hear me! I will roar!
do it too terribly. You would fright the Duchess and the ladies that they would shriek, and that were enough to hang us all.
That would hang us. I grant you, friends, if you should fright the ladies out of their wits, they should have no more discretion but to hang us. But I will aggravate my voice so that I will roar you as gently as any sucking dove. I will roar you into any nightingale.
You must play no part but Pyramus. For Pyramus is vain. Sweet-faced man. A proper man, one shall see in a summer's day. A most lovely, gentleman-like man. Therefore, you must needs play Pyramus.
Well, I will undertake it.
Master, here are your partners. And I am to entreat you, request you, and desire you to calm them by tomorrow night. Meet me in the palace wood, a mile without the tower by moonlight. There we will rehearse. For if we meet in the city, we shall be dogged with company and our devices known. I pray you, fail me not.
We will meet, and there we may rehearse most obscenely and courageously. Take pains, be perfect. Adieu.
At the Duke's Oak, we meet!
No, pull or cut those strings.
Spoil the ale. the wisest aunt, telling the saddest tale. Sometime for a 3-foot stool mistaketh me. Then slip I from her bum, down double she, and terrorize falls into a cough, 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 cough. And the whole choir hold their hips and laugh, and knees and swear that never a merrier hour was wasted there. Broom fairy, here comes your broom.
You're my mistress. What if you were gone?
Ill met by moonlight, proud Titania.
What? Jealous Oberon? Fairies, skip hence. I have forsworn his bed and company.
Tarry, rash, wanton. Am not I thy lord?
And I must be thy lady. But I know when thou hast stolen away from Fairyland, I'm in the shape of Florence that all day, playing on pipes of corn and bursting love. To amorous, will it all? Why art thou here? Come from the farthest steep of India, but forsooth, the bouncing Amazon, your busking mistress, and your warrior love, to Theseus must be wedded. And you come to give their bed joy and prosperity.
How canst thou thus, Titania? Glance at my credit with Hippolyta, knowing I know thy love to Theseus.
These are the forgeries of jealousy! And never since the middle summer spring met we on hill and dale, by forest or mead, by paved fountain, or by rushy brook, or on the beached margins of the sea to dance our ringlets to the whistling wind. But with thy brawls thou hast disturbed our sport. Therefore the winds, piping to us in vain, as in revenge, have sucked up from the sea contagious fogs, which, falling in the land, hath every pelting river made so proud that they have overborne their continents. The ox hath therefore stretched his yoke in vain, the ploughman lost his flesh, and the green corn hath rotted ere his youth attained a beard. The human mortals want their winter here. No night is now with him, or carol blessed. Therefore the moon, the governess of bloods, pale in her anger, washes all the air that rheumatic diseases do abound. And through this temperature we see the seasons alter. Hoary-headed frosts fall in the fresh lap of the crimson rose, and on Alhaium's thin, an icy crown, an odorous chaplet of sweet summer buds is, as in mockery, set. Spring, summer, the childing autumn, angry winter change their wonted liveries, and the maiden world by their increase now knows not which is which, and this same progeny of evils comes from our debate, from our dissension. We are their parents and original.
Do you amend it then? It lies in you.
Why should Titania cross her own brow? I do but beg a little changeling boy to be my henchman.
Set your heart at rest. The fairyland buys not the child of me. His mother was a votress of my order, and in a spicy demeanor by my full often hath she gossiped by my side and sat with me on Neptune's yellow sands, marking the invited traitors on the flood. When we have laughed, the sails conceive and grow big-bellied with the wanton wind, which she, with pretty and with swimming gait following, would have taken, and sail upon the land to fetch me trifles and return again, as from a voyage rich with merchandise. But she, being mortal, of that boy did die, and for her sake do I rear up her boy, and for her sake I will not part with him.
How long within this wood intend you stay?
Perchance till after Theseus' wedding day? If you will patiently dance in our round and see our moonlight revels, go with us. If not, shun me, and I will spare your haunt.
I will go with thee. Give me that child, and I will go with thee.
Not for thy fairy kingdom. Fairies away! We shall set down ready for longer stay.
Well, go thy way! Thou shalt not from this grove till I torment thee for this injury! My gentle Puck, you come hither. Thou rememberest, since once I sat upon a promontory and heard a mermaid on a dolphin's back uttering such dulcet and harmonious breath that the rude sea grew civil at her song, and certain stars shot madly from their spheres to hear the sea maid's music.
I remember.
That very time I saw, but thou couldst not, flying between the cold moon and the earth, Cupid all off, a certain aim he took at a fair vestal, thrown it by the west, and loosed his love shaft smartly from his bow, as it should pierce 100,000 hearts. But I might see young Cupid's fiery shaft quenched in the chaste beams of the watery moon, and the imperial votaress is passed on in maiden meditation, fancy free. Yet marked I where the bolt of Cupid fell. It fell upon a little western flower, before milk white, now purple with love's wound. And maidens call it love in idleness. Fetch me that flower, the herb I showed thee once. The juice of it on sleeping eyelids laid will make or man or woman madly dote on the next live creature that it sees. Fetch me the herb, and be thou here again ere the Leviathan can swim a league.
I'll put a girdle about the earth in 40 minutes.
Having once this juice, I'll watch Titania when she is asleep, and drop the liquor of it in her eye. The next thing that she waking looks upon, be it lion, bear, on wolf or bull, on meddling monkey or on busy ape, she shall pursue it with the soul of love. And ere I take this charm from off her sight, as I can take it with another herb, I'll make her render up her page to me! But who comes here? I'm invisible and will overhear their conference.
I love thee not, therefore pursue me not. Where is Lysander and fair Hermia? The one I'll slay, the other slayeth me. Thou toldst me they were stolen into this wood, and here I am in woe within this wood, because I cannot meet with Hermia, hence get thee gone, and follow me no more!
You draw me, you hard-hearted adamant, and yet you draw not iron, for my heart is as true as steel. Leave me your power to draw, and I shall have no power to follow you!
Do I entice you? Do I speak you fair? Or rather, do I not in plainest truth tell you I do not, or I cannot love you?
And even for that do I love you the more. I am your spaniel, and Demetrius, the more you beat me, I will fawn on you. Use me but as your spaniel! Burn me, strike me, neglect me, move me! Only give me leave, unworthy as I am, to follow you! Oh, where's your place, can I beg in your love? Be yet a place of high respect to me, to be used as you use your dog!
Tempt not too much the hatred of my spirit, for I am sick when I do look on thee!
And I am sick when I look not on you!
You do impede your modesty too much! To leave the city and commit yourself to the hands of one that loves you not, to trust the opportunity of night in the ill counsel of a desert place with the rich worth of your virginity.
Your virtue is my privilege, but that it is not night when I do see your face. And how can it be that I am in the night? Nor does this wood lack worlds and company, for you and I expect are all the world, and how can it be that I am a lover of all the world here to look on me?
I'll run from thee, and hide me in the brakes, and leave thee to the mercy of the wild beast.
The wildest hath not such a heart as you. Run when you will. The story shall be changed. Apollo flies and Daphne holds the chase. The dove pursues the griffin. The mild hind makes speed to catch the tiger. Bootless speed when cowardice pursues and valor flies.
I will not stay thy questions. Let me go. Or if thou follow me, do not believe, but I shall do thee mischief in the wood.
Aye, in the temple, in the town, the field. You do me mischief. Fly, Demetrius. You're wrong to set a scandal on my sex. We cannot fight for love as men may do. We should be wooed. We're not made to woo. I'll follow thee and make a heaven of hell to die upon the hand I love so well.
Fare thee well, nymph. Ere he do leave this grove, thou shalt fly him, and he shall seek thy love. Hast thou the flower there? Welcome, wanderer.
Aye, there it is.
I pray thee, give it me. I know a beck where on the wild thyme blows, where ox slips and the nodding violet grows quite over canopy with luscious woodbine, with sweet musk roses and with eglantine. There sleeps Titania some time of the night, lulled in these flowers with dances and delights. And there the snake throws her enameled skin weed wide enough to wrap a fairy in. And with the juice of this, I'll streak her eyes and make her full of hateful fantasies. Take thou some of it, and seek through this grove. A sweet Athenian lady is in love with a disdainful youth. Anoint his eyes, but do it when the next thing he espies may be the lady. Thou shalt know the man by the Athenian garments he hath on, affected with some care that he may prove more fond on her than she upon her love. And look thou meet me ere the first cock crows.
Never fear, my lord, your servant shall do so.
When thou dost wake, do it for thy true love take. Love and languish for his sake, be it ounce or cat or bear, pard or boar with bristled hair. In thy eye that does appear, when thou wakes, it is thy dear. Wake when some vile thing is near.
Fair love, your fate was wandering in the wood. Speak trope. I forgot our way. Well, rest us, Hermia, if you think it good, and tarry for the comfort of the day.
Be so, Lysander, find you out of bed, for I upon this bank will rest my head.
One turf shall serve as pillow for us both. One bed, one heart, two bosoms in one trope.
Hey, good Lysander, for my sake, my dear, lie further off yet. Do not lie so near.
Take the sense, sweet of my innocence. Love takes the meaning in love's conference. I mean that my heart unto yours is knit, so then but one heart we can make of it. Two bosoms entertained with an oath, so then two bosoms in a single shroom. Then, by your side, no venture me denied. For lying so, Hermie, I do not lie.
Lysander riddles very prettily. Now much beshrew my manners and my pride if Hermia meant to stay, Lysander lied. But, gentle friend, for love and courtesy, lie further off in human modesty. Such separation, as may well be said, becomes a virtuous bachelor and a maid. So far be distant, and good night, sweet friend. Thy love ne'er alter till thy sweet life end.
Amen. Amen to that fair prayer, say I. Then end life when I end loyalty. Here is my bed. We give thee all this rest.
And pass that wish, the wisher's eyes be pressed.
To the forest have I gone, but Athenian found I none, on whose eyes I might approve this flower's force and stirring love. Night and silence! Who is here? Reeds of Athens he doth wear? This is he, my master said, despises the Athenian maid. And the maiden sleeping sound on the dank and dirty ground. She durst not lie near this lack love, this kill courtesy. Churl, on thine eyes I throw all the force this flower doth owe. When thou wakest, let love forbid sleep his seat on thy eyelid. Now, awake! When I am gone, for I must now to Oberon.
Fatal, thou kill me, sweet Demetrius.
I charge thee hence, do not haunt me thus.
Oh, wilt thou darken, leave me, do not so.
Stay on thy peril, I alone will go.
Oh. I am out of breath in this fond chase. The more my prayer, the lesser is my grace. Happy is Hermia, for sore she lies, for she hath blessed and attractive eyes. How came her eye so bright? Not with all tears. If so, my eyes are oftener watched than hers. No, no, I am as ugly as a bear, for beasts that meet me run away for fear. Therefore no marvel though Demetrius do as a monster fly my presence thus. What wicked and dissembling glass of mine made me compare with Hermia's fiery eyes? But who's here? Lysander, on the ground. Dead or asleep? I see no blood, no wound. Lysander, if you live, good sir, awake!
And run through fire I will for thy sweet sake.
And transparent Helena, nature so dark that through thy bosom makes me see thy heart. Where is Demetrius? Oh, how fit a word is that vile name to perish on my sword!
Do not say so, Lysander! Say not so! Oh, what though he love your Hermia? Lord, what though? Yeah, Hermia still loves you, then be content!
Content with Hermia?
No, I do repent the tedious minutes I with her have spent.
Not Hermia?
The Helena I love. I would not change a raven for a dove. The will of man is by his reason swayed, and reason says you are the way to remain. Things growing are not ripe till they're seasoned, so I, being young, shall not ripen thus reason. Touching now the point of human skill, reason becomes the martial to my will. And leads me to your eyes, where I overlook love story written in love.
Oh, wherefore was I to this king off reborn? When at your hands did I deserve this scorn? Is that enough? It's not enough, young man, that I did never, no, nor never can, deserve a sweet look from Demetrius' eye, but you must plot my insufficiency. Good troth, you do me wrong. Good sooth, you do. Such disdainful manner me to woo. But fare you well. Force I must confess. I thought you, Lord, a more true gentleness. So that a lady of one man refused should of another therefore be abused.
He sees not Hermia? Hermia sleeps out there and never may come Lysander near. For as the surfeit of the sweetest thinks, the deepest loathing do the stomach brings. For as the heresies that men do leave are hated most of those they did deceive. So now, my surfeit and my heresy have all be hated but the most of me. And all my powers address your love and might to honor Helen and to be her knight.
Help me, Lysander, help me do thy best to pluck this crawling serpent from my breast. Try me, for pity, what a dream was here. Lysander, look how I do quake with fear. Methought a serpent ate my heart away, and you sat smiling at its cruel prey. Lysander! What? Removed? Lysander, Lord! What? Out of hearing? Gone? No sound? No word? Alack, where are you? Pagan, if you hear, speak of all loves. I swoon almost with fear. No? Then I'll perceive you are that nigh. Either death or you I'll find immediately.
And his beard was stained.
Are we all met?
Hat, hat! And here is a marvelous convenient place for our rehearsal. We shall do it in an action as we shall do before the Duke.
Peter Quince!
What sayest thou, Bully Bottom?
There are things in this comedy of Pyramus and Thisbe that will never please. First, Pyramus must draw a sword to kill himself, which the ladies cannot abide. How answer you that?
I believe we must leave the killing out when all is done.
Not a whit. I have a device to make all well. Write me a prologue, and let the prologue seem to say we will do no harm with our swords, and that Pyramus is not killed indeed. And for the more better assurance, tell him that I, Pyramus, am not Pyramus, but Bottom the Weaver. This will put them out of fear.
We will have such a prologue, and it shall be written in 86.
No, make it two more. Let it be written in 8 and 8.
Will not the ladies be afeard of the lion?
I fear it, I promise you.
Oh, lady among lions is a most dreadful thing, for there is not a more fearful wildfowl than your lion living, and we ought to look to it.
Therefore, another prologue must tell he is not a lion.
Nay, half his face must be seen through the lion's neck, and he himself must speak through, saying thus or to the same defect, ladies or fair ladies, I would wish you, I would request you, I would entreat you not to fear, not to tremble. If you think I come hither as a lion, I am no such thing. I am a man as other men are. And there indeed, let him name his name and tell them plainly that he is Snug the Joiner.
Well, it shall be so, but there is two hard things. That is to bring moonlight into a chamber, for Pyramus and Thisbe meet by moonlight.
Doth the moon shine that night we play our play?
A calendar! A calendar! Look in the almanac! Find out, moonshine! Find out, moonshine!
Yes, it doth shine that night!
Why then, may you leave a casement of the great chamber window where we play open, and the moon may shine in at the casement.
Else, one must come in with a bush of thorns and a lantern, and say he come to disfigure or to present the person of moonshine. Then there is another thing, to bring a wall into the great chamber, for Pyramus and Thisbe says the story, did talk to the chief of a wall.
You can never bring in a wall. What say you, Bottom?
Some man or other must present wall, and let him have some plaster or some loam or some rough cast about him to signify wall, and let him hold his fingers thus, and through that cranny shall Pyramus and Thisbe whisper.
If that may be, then all is well. Come, sit and rehearse your part. Pyramus, you begin. When you have spoken your speech, enter into that break, and so everyone according to his cue.
What camping homespun have we swaggering here, so near to the cradle of the fairy queen? What? A play? I'll be an auditor. And an actor, too, if I see come.
Speak, Pyramus.
Thisbe, the flowers of odious savour sweet.
Odors
savour sweet. So hath thy breath my dearest Thisbe dear. But hark, a voice. Stay thou but here a while, and by I will to thee appear.
A stranger, Pyramus, than e'er played here.
Must I speak now?
Aye, marry, must. For you must understand, he goes but to see a noise that he heard, and is to come again.
Absolutely, white of you, of gold, like red rose on triumphant fire, most frisky juvenile, and meek, most lovely Jew. As true as true as tosh, fashioned with river tire. How meet thee, dear miss, that ninny's too.
Nine it is too, men. Why, you must not speak that yet. That you answer to Pyramus. Take all your parts at once, cues and all. Pyramus, enter. Your cue is past. It is never tire.
As true as true as toss. That would never tire.
If I were fair Thisbe, I were only thine.
A monster! A great! We are lost!
Painted butterflies and the moonbeams from
from his sleeping eyes. Nod to him, elf, and do him courtesies.
I cry your worship's mercy, heartily. I beseech your worship's name.
Cobweb?
I shall desire more acquaintance of you, good Master Cobweb. If I cut my finger, I shall make bold with you. Your name, honest gentleman? Ah, Master Peace Blossom, I pray you commend me to Mistress Squash, your mother, and to Master Peace God, your father. Your name, I beseech you, sir.
Mustard Seed.
Good Master Mustard Seed, I know your patience well. The same cowardly giant-like ox thief have devoured many gentlemen of your house. I promise you, your kindred hath made mine eyes water ere now. I shall desire you of more acquaintance, good Master Mustard Seed.
Come! Wait upon him. Lead him to my bower. Tie up my love's tongue. Bring him to me.
She must be eyed.
Stand close. This is the same Athene.
This is the woman, but not this the man.
Oh, why rebuke you him that loves you so? Lay breath so bitter on your bitter foe.
Now I but tried, but I should use thee worse. For thou, I fear, hast given me cause to curse. If thou hast slain Lysander in his sleep, being o'er shoes and blood, plunge in the deep and kill me too. The sun was not so true unto the day as he to me, which we have stole away from sleeping Hermia. It cannot be, but thou hast murdered him. So should a murderer look, so dead, so grim.
So should the murdered look, and so should I. Pierced through the heart with your stern cruelty. If you, the murderer, look as bright, as clear, as yonder Venus in her glimmering sphere.
What's this to my Lysander? Where is he? How good Demetrius, wilt thou give him to me?
I'd rather give his carcass to my hound.
Oh, dog, thou cur, thou drivest me past the bounds of made his patience. Hast thou slain him then? Henceforth never be numbered among men. Oh, once, tell true even for my sake. Durst thou look upon him being awake? And hast thou killed him sleeping? Oh, brave touch. Could not a worm, an adder, do so much? An adder did it, for with doubler tongue than thine, thou serpent, never adder stung.
You spend your passion on a misplied mood. I'm not guilty of Lysander's blood, nor is he dead, for all that I can tell.
I pray thee, tell me then that he is well.
If I could, what should I get there for?
A privilege never to see me more, and from thy hated presence part I so. See me no more, whether he be dead or no.
There's no following her in this fierce vein. Here, therefore, for a while I will remain. Till sorrow's heaviness doth heavier grow, for it's death that bankrupt sleep doth sorrow owe, which now in some slight measure it will pay. War is tender here, I make some stay.
What hast thou done? Thou hast mistaken quite, and laid the love juice on some true love's sight. Of thy misprision must perforce ensue, some true love turned, and not a false turn true. About the wood go, swifter than the wind, and Helena of Athens look thou find. All fancy sick she is, and pale of cheer, with sighs of love that cost the fresh blood dear. By some illusion, look thou bring her here. I'll charm his eyes against she do appear.
I go. See how I go. Swifter than arrow from Tartar's bow.
Flower of this purple dye, hit with Cupid's archery, sink in apple of his eye. When his love he doth espy, let her shine as gloriously as the Venus of the sky. When you wake, if she be by, beg of her for remedy.
Captain of our ferry band, Helena, he's here at hand, and the youth mistook by me, pleading for a lover's fee. Shall we their fond pageant see? Lord, what fools these mortals be!
Stand aside, the noise they make will cause Demetrius to awake.
Then we'll two at once woo one, and this must needs be sport alone. These things do best please me, let befall preposterously.
Why should you think that I should ruin scorn? Scorn and derision never come in tears. Look, when I vow, I weep, and vow so born in their nativity all truth appears. How can these things in me seem scorn to you, bearing the badge of faith that proves them true?
You do advance your cunning more and more, when truth kills truth. Oh, devilish, holy prey! These vows are Hermia's. Will you give her o'er? Weigh oath with oath, and you will nothing weigh. Your vows to her and me put in two scales will even weigh, and both as light as tail.
I had no judgment when to her I swore.
Nor none of my mind now you give her o'er.
Demetrius loves her, and he loves not you.
Oh, Helen, goddess, nymph, perfect, divine, to what my love shall I compare thine eyes? Crystal is muddy, oh, let me kiss this princess of pure white, this seal of bliss.
Oh, hell! I see you all are bent to set against me for your merriment. If you were civil and knew courtesy, you would not do me thus much injury. Can you not hate me as I know you do? But you must join in souls to bond me too. If you were men, as men you are in show, you would not use a gentle lady so. To vow and swear and super praise my parts, when I am sure you hate me with your heart. You both are rivals and love Hermia. And now both rivals to mock Helena. A trim exploit, a manly enterprise, to conjure tears up in a poor man's eyes of your derision. None of noble sort would so avenge a fed virgin and extort a poor soul's patience, all to make you sport.
You are unkind, Demetrius, be not so, for you love Hermia, this you know I know. And here, with all goodwill, with all my heart, in Hermia's love I yield you up my part, and yours of Helena to me bequeath, whom I do love. And will love till my death.
No, for I've never been mocked or played for idle breath.
Lysander, keep thy Hermia, I will none. If e'er I loved her, all I love is gone. My heart to her, but as guestwise sojourned. And now to Helen it is home returned, there to remain.
Helen, it is not so.
Disparage not the faith thou dost not know, lest to thy peril thou abide, dear. Look where thy love comes, yonder is thy dear.
Dark night, that from the eye is function takes. The ear more quick of apprehension makes, wherein it doth impair the seeing sense. It pays the hearing double recompense. Thou art not by mine eye, Lysander, found. My ear, I think, it brought me to thy sound. But why unkindly didst thou leave me so?
Why should he stay, whom love doth press to go?
With love to press Lysander from thy side.
Lysander's love that would not let him bide?
Fair Helena, the more in guilt tonight than all yon fiery oaths and eyes of light.
Why seekest thou me?
Could not this make thee know? The hate I bear thee made me leave thee so.
You speak not as you think he cannot be. Oh, she is one of this confederacy. Now I perceive they have to join all three to fashion this false sport in spite of me. Injurious Hermia, most ungrateful maid, have you conspired? Have you with these contrived to bait me with this foul derision? It's all the counsel that we two have shared. It's the sisters' vow. The hours that we have spent when we have chid the hasty for the time departing us, oh, it's all for cause. All school days, friendship, childhood, innocence. We, Hermia, like two artificial gods, have with our needles created both one flower, both on one sampler, sitting on one cushion, both warbling of one song, both in one key, as if our hands, our sighs, voices, and minds have been incorporate. And will you rend our ancient love asunder to join with men in scorning your poor friend? It is not friendly. Tis not maidenly. Our sex, as well as I, may chide you for it, though I alone do feel the injury.
I am amazed at your passionate words. I scorn you not. It seems that you scorn me.
Have you not that Lysander, as in scorn, to follow me, appraise my eyes and face, and made your other love, Demetrius, who even now but did spurn me with his foot, to call me goddess, nymph, divine, rare, precious, celestial? Wherefore speaks he this to her he hates? And wherefore doth Lysander deny your love, so rich within his soul? Tender me, forsooth, affection, but by your setting on, by your consent. What though I be not so hung upon in love as you, so hung upon with love so fortunate, but miserable most to love unloved? This you should pity rather than despise.
I understand not what you mean by this.
I do persever. Counterfeit sad looks, make mouths upon me when I turn my back. Wink at each other. Hold the sweet jest up. This sport well carried shall be chronicled. If you have any pity, grace, or manners, you would not make me such an argument. But fare you well. 'Tis partly my own fault, which death or absence soon shall remedy.
Stay! Gentle Helena, hear my excuse. My love, my life, my soul, fair Helena.
Oh, excellent!
We do not scorn her so.
She cannot entreat, I can compel.
Thou can't compel, no more than she entreat.
My threats have no more strength than her retreats. Helen, I love thee, by my life I do. I swear that by which I will lose for thee to prove him false. Says I love thee not.
I say I love thee more than he can do.
If thou say so, withdraw and prove it too.
Quit, come.
Lysander, where'd you tongue all this?
Take off, thou calf, thou bird. Vile thing, let loose, or I'll shake thee from me like a serpent.
Why are you grown so rude? What changes this sweet love?
Thy love outloadeth medicine, hated potions hence.
Do you not just?
Yes, Zeus, and so do you.
Demetrius, I will keep my word with thee.
And would I had your bond, for I perceive a weak bond, hold. Come on, trust your word.
What? Did I hurt her? Strike her? Kill her dead? Although I hate her, I'll not harm her so.
What? Can you do me greater harm than hate? Hate me? Wherefore, oh me, what new is my love? Am not I Hermia? Are not you Lysander? I am as fair now as I was erewhile. Since night you love me, yet since night you left me. Why then, you left me. Oh, the gods forbid, in earnest, shall I say?
Aye, by my life, I never did desire to see thee more. Therefore, be out of hope, of a question of doubt. Be certain nothing true. It's no jest that I do hate thee. Love Helena.
Oh, me, you juggler, you canker blossom, you thief of love. What, have you come by night and stole my lord's heart from him?
Fine, in faith. Have you no modesty, no maiden shame, no touch of bashfulness? What would you tear impatient answers from my gentle tongue? Fie, you counterfeit, you puppet, you puppet!
Why so? Aye, that way goes the game. Now I perceive that she hath made compare between our statures. She hath urged her height, and with her personage, her tall personage, her height, forsooth, she hath prevailed with him. And are you grown so high in his esteem because I am so dwarfish and so low? How low am I, thou painted maypole? Speak! How low am I? I am not yet so low, but that my nails can reach into thine eyes!
I pray you, though you mock me, gentlemen, let her not hurt me! I was never cursed. I have no gift at all in shrewishness. I am a right maid for my cowardice. Let her not hurt me. You may perhaps think, because she is something lower than myself, that I can match her.
Lower? Hark again!
Good Hermia, do not be so bitter with me. I evermore did love you, Hermia. Did ever keep your counsel. Never wronged you. Say that in love unto Demetrius. I told him of yourself into this wood.
What?
He followed you. For love, I followed him. But he hath chid me hence, and threatened me to strike me, spurn me, nay, to kill me too. And now, so you will let me quiet go. To Athens will I bear my folly back and follow you no farther. Let me go. You see how simple and how fond I am.
I get you gone. Who is it that hinders you?
Foolish heart that I leave here behind.
What, would Lysander let Demetrius?
Be not afraid. She'll not harm thee, Helena.
No, sir, she shall not, though you take her part.
Oh, when she's angry, she's keen and shrewd. She was a vixen when she went to school, and though she be but little, she is fierce.
Little again? Nothing but little. Why will you suffer her to flout me thus? Let me come to her.
Get you gone, you dwarf. You minimus of Hendrick Notgrass, man, you beat, you acorn.
You are too officious in her behalf that scorns her services. Let her alone. Speak not of Helena. Take not her part, for if thou dost intend never so little show of love to her, thou shalt abide.
Now she holds me not. Now follow if thou darest to try's right of thine, or mine is most in Helena.
Follow? Nay, I'll go with thee cheek by jowl.
You, mistress, all this coil is long of you. Nay, go not back.
I will not trust you, I, nor longer stay in your cursed company. Your hands and mine are quicker for a fray. My legs are longer, though, to run away.
I am amazed, and know not what to say.
This is thy negligence. Still, thou mistakes, or else commits thy knaveries willfully.
Believe me, King of Shadows, I mistook. Didst not you tell me that I should know the man by the Athenian garments he had on? Therefore, brave and blameless proves my enterprise, that I have anointed an Athenian's eyes. And so far, I am glad it did so, sir. As they're jangling, I esteem a sport.
Thou seest these lovers seek a place to fight. Hie, therefore, Robin, overcast the night. The story, welkin, cover thou anon with drooping fog as black as Acheron, and lead these testy rivals so astray as one come not within another's way. Like to Lysander, sometime frame thy tongue, then stir Demetrius up with bitter wrong. And then sometime rail thou like Demetrius, and from each other look thou lead them thus, till o'er their brow death counterfeiting sleep with leaden legs and batty wings doth creep. Then crush this herb into Lysander's eye. The juice, whose juice hath this virtuous property to take from thence all error with his might, and make his eyeballs roll with wonted sight. When they next wake, all this derision will seem a dream and fruitless vision. Whilst I in this affair do thee employ, I'll to my queen and beg her Indian boy, and then I will her charmed eye release from monster's view, and all things shall be peace.
Up and down. Up and down. I will lead them. Up and down. I am fierce in field and town. Goblin, lead them up and down. Here comes one.
Where art thou, proud Demetrius? Speak thou now.
Follow my voice. We'll try no manhood here.
I will be with thee straight.
Follow me then to plainer ground.
Lysander, speak again. Thou run away, thou coward, art thou fled? Speak, in some bush, where dost thou hide thy head?
Thou coward, art thou bragging to the stars, telling the bushes that thou look'st for wolves and wilt not come? Come, recreant, come now, child. I'll whip thee with the rod, here's the vial that draws the sword on thee.
Yea, art thou there?
Follow my voice, we'll try no manhood here.
Rope's before me, still bears me on. I come where he calls, and he's gone. The villain is much lighter heeled than I. I followed fast, but faster he did fly. Fallen am I, in dark uneven way. And here will rest me. Come, thou gentle day. For if but once thy show me thy great light, I'll find Demetrius and revenge this fight.
Ha 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 ha! Coward! Why comest thou not?
Find me if thou darest, for well I wot thou runnest before me, shifting every place, but darest not stand or look me in the face. Where art thou?
Come hither, I am here!
Nay then, thou mockest me. Thou shalt abide dear if ever I thy face by daylight see. Go thy way. Faintness constraineth me to measure out my length on this cold bed. My day's approach. Look to be visited.
Oh, weary night! Oh, long and tedious night! Abate thy hours! Like comforts from the east, that I may back to Athens by daylight, from thee that my poor company detest. Oh, and sleep, that sometimes shuts up sorrow's eye, steal me a while for mine own company.
Yet, but three, come one more, two of both kinds makes up four. Here she comes, Kirsten sad. Cupid is a knavish lad. That's to make poor females mad.
Ever so weary, ever so in woe, bedabbled with the dew and torn with briars. I can no further crawl, no further go. My legs can keep no pace with my desires. Here will I rest me till the break of day. Heaven shield Lysander if they mean a fray.
On the ground, sleep sound. All apply to your eye, gentle lover. Remedy. When thou wakest, thou takest true delight in thy former lady's eye. And the country proverb known that each man should take his own. Jack shall have Jill, naught shall go ill.
the man shall have his mare again, and all shall be well.
When the other do, may all to Athens back again repair, and think of this night's accidents as but the fierce vexation of a dream. But first, I will release the fairy queen. Be as thou was wont to be,
See as thou was wont to see. Dian's bud or Cupid's flower hath such force and blessed power. Now, my Titania, wake you, my sweet queen.
Oh, my Oberon. Oh, what visions have I seen? Me thought I was enamored of an ass.
There was your love.
Oh, how mine eyes do loathe this visage now.
Now silence a while. Robin, take off his head. Titania, strike more. Music, call and strike more dead than come and sleep of all these five the sense.
Music? Oh, music? Such as charmeth sleep.
When thou wakest with thine own full strife, peep!
Sound, music. Come, my queen, take hands with me. And rock the ground whereon these sleepers be. Now thou and I are new in amity and will tomorrow midnight solemnly dance and Duke Theseus' house triumphantly. And blessed to all fair prosperity, there shall these pairs of faithful lovers be wedded with Theseus all in jollity.
Fairy King, attend him up, for I do hear the morning lark.
Then, my queen, in silence sad, trip we after night's shade. We the globe can compass soon, swifter than the wandering moon.
Come, my lord, and in our flight, tell me how it came this night that I sleeping here was found with these mortals on the ground.
The music of my house. We will, fair queen, up to the mountain's top and mark the musical confusion of hounds and echo in conjunction. But soft, what nymphs are these?
My lord, this is my daughter here asleep. And this Lysander. This Demetrius here. This Helena, old Manor's Helena. I do wonder what bring them here together.
But no doubt they rose up early to observe the rite of May, and hearing our intents, came here in grace of our solemnity. But speak, Aegeus, is not this the day that Hermia should give answer of her choice?
It is, my lord.
Good morrow, friends! St. Valentine is past! Begin these whispers, but a couple now.
Pardon, my lord.
I pray you all stand up. I know you two are rival enemies. How comes this gentle concord in the world that
Hatred is so far from jealousy, to sleep by hate and fear no enmity.
My lord, I shall reply amazingly. Half sleep, half waking. But as yet, I swear I cannot truly say how I came here. But as I think, for truly I would speak. Now I do bethink me. So it is. I came here with Hermia hither. Our intent was to be gone from Athens, where we might be without the peril of the Athenian law.
Enough! Enough, my lord! You have enough! I beg the law upon his head. They would have stolen away, they would have, Demetrius. They would have defeated you and me. You of your wife, and me of my consent for her to be your wife.
My lord, fair Helen told me of their stealth, of this their purpose hither to this wood, and I in fury followed them. Fair Helena and Fancy following me. But, my lord, I wot not by what power, but by some power it is, my love to Hermia melted as the snow. Seems to me now as the remembrance of an idle god, which in my childhood I did dote upon. And all the faith, the virtue of my heart, the object and pleasure of mine eye is only Helena. To her, my lord, was I betrothed ere I saw Hermia, but like a sickness did I loathe this food. But as it health come to my natural taste, now I do wish it, love it, long for it, and will forevermore be true to it.
Fair lovers, you are fortunately met. Of this discourse we more will hear anon. Aegeus, I will overbear your will, for in the temple, by and by with us, these couples shall eternally be knit. And for the morning now is something warned, our purpose hunting shall be set aside. Away with us to Athens, three and three. We'll hold a feast in great solemnity. Come, Hippolyta.
These things seem small and undistinguishable, like far off mountains turning into clouds.
Methinks I see things with parted eyes, where everything seems double, so amazing. Now I have found Demetrius like a jewel, mine own and not mine own.
It seems to me that yet we sleep, we dream. Do not you think the Duke was here and bid us follow him?
Why, then we are awake. Let's follow him. And by the way, let us recount our dreams.
When my cue comes, call me and I will answer. My next is
most fabulous.
Hi ho, Peter Quince. Loot the bellows, Mander. Now the tinker. Guards my life, stolen hence, and left me asleep. I have had a most rare vision. I've had a dream. Pass the wit of man to say what dream it was. Man is but an ass if you go about to expound this dream. To me thought I was, there's no man can tell what. And methought I was, and methought I have. Man is but a patched fool if he will offer to say what methought I had. The eye of man hath not heard, the ear of man hath not seen. Man's hand is not able to taste, his tongue to conceive, nor his heart to report what my dream was. I will get Peter Quince to write a ballad of this dream. It shall be called Bottom's Dream, because it hath no bottom. And I will sing it at the latter end of a play before the Duke. Peradventure, to make it the more gracious, I shall sing it at her death.
Have you sent to
recorded.
If he come not, then the play is marred. It goes not forward, doth it?
It is not possible. There is not a man in all Athens able to discharge Pyramus but he.
No, he hath simply the best wit of any handicraft man in Athens.
Yea, and the best person, too. And he is the very paramour for a sweet voice.
You must say paragon. A paramour is, bless us, a thing of naught.
Masters! Masters! The Duke is coming from the temple. And there's two or three lords and ladies more married. If our sport had gone forward, we'd have been made men.
Where are these lads? Where are these heralds?
Oh, most courageous day, oh, most a happy hour.
Masters, I am to discourse wonders. But ask me not what, for if I tell you, I am not true Athenian. I will tell you everything right as it fell out.
Let us hear, sweet bottom.
Not a word of me. All I will tell you is, the Duke hath died. Get your apparel together, good strings to your beards, new ribbons to your pumps. Gather presently at the palace, every man look all his part, for the short and long is, our play is prepared.
Yeah!
In any case, let
his be half clean linen.
And let not him that plays the lion tear his nails, for they shall hang out as the lion's claws. And most dear actors, eat no onions nor garlic, for we are to utter sweet breath. And I do not doubt but to hear them say this is sweet comedy. No more words. Away, go away.
That these lovers speak of?
More strange than true. I never may believe these antique fables, nor these fairy toys. Lovers and madmen have such seething brains, such shaping fantasies, that apprehend more than cool reason ever comprehends. The lunatic, the lover, and the poet are of imagination all compact. One sees more devils than vast hell can hold. That is the madman. The lover, all is frantic, sees Helen's beauty in a brow of Egypt. The poet's eye, in a fine frenzy rolling, doth glance from heaven to earth, from earth to heaven. And as imagination bodies forth the forms of things unknown, the poet's pen turns them to shapes and gives to airy nothing a local habitation and a name. Such tricks have strong imagination that if they would but apprehend some joy, they comprehend some bringer of that joy. Or in the night, imagining some fear, how easy is a bush supposed a bear?
Oh, but all the story of the night told over and all their minds transfigured so together, more witnesses than fancy's images, and growth to something of great constancy, but howsoever strange and admirable.
Here come the lovers, full of joy and mirth. Joy, gentle friends, joy and fresh days of love accompany your hearts.
More than to us, wait in your royal walks, your board, your bed.
Come now, what masks, what dances shall we have to wear away this long age of 3 hours between our after supper and bedtime? What revels are in hand? Is there no play to ease the anguish of a torturing hour? Say, what abridgment have we for this evening? What mask, what music? How shall we beguile the lazy time if not with some delight?
A play there is, my lord.
Who are they? What are they that do play it?
Hard-handed men who work in Athens here.
Which never toiled in their minds till now, and now do wreathe their untoiled memories in this same play against your nuptial.
And we will hear it.
No, no, lord. It's not for you. I've heard it through, and it is nothing, nothing in this world. Unless you find sport in their intent, extremely stretched and conned with cruel pain to do you service.
I hear that play, for never anything can be amiss when simpleness and duty tender it.
So be your grace, the prologue is addressed.
To think we come not to offend, but with goodwill. To show our simple skill, that is the true beginning of our end. Consider then we come but in despite. We do not come as minding to content you. Our true intent is, all for your delight, we are not here. That you should here repent you. The actors are at hand, and by their show you shall know all that you are like to know.
This fellow doth not stand upon point. Oh. He hath writ his prologue like a rough colt. He knows not to stop.
Indeed, he hath played on this prologue like a child on a recorder. A sound, but not in government.
His speech was like a tangled chain. I'm nothing impaired, but all disordered. Who is next?
Perchance you wonder at this show, but wonder on, till truth make all things plain. This man, Pyramus, if you would know, beauteous lady, Thisbe is certain. This man with lime and rough cast doth present wall, that vile wall which did these lovers sunder, and through wall's chink, poor souls, they are content to whisper, at the which let no man wonder. This man with lanthorn, dog, and bush of thorn presented moonshine. For, if you will know, by moonshine did these lovers think no scorn but to meet at Ninus's tomb there. There's me. This grisly beast, which by name Lionhight, the trusty Thisbe coming first by night, did scare away, or rather did affright. And as she fled, her mantle she did fall, which lion vile, bloody mouth did stain. Anon comes Pyramus, sweet youth and tall, and finds his trusty Thisbe's mantle slain. Whereat with bloody blameful blade, he bravely broached his boiling bloody breast. And Thisbe, tarrying in mulberry shade, his dagger drew and died. For all the rest, let lion, moonshine, wall, and lovers twain at large discourse while here they do remain.
I wonder if lion be to speak.
No wonder, my lord, one lion may, when many asses do.
In this same interlude, it doth befall that I, one snout by name, present a wall, and such a wall as I would have you think that had in it a cranny hole or chink through which the lovers Pyramus and Thisbe did whisper often very secretly. This loam, this rough cast, and this stone doth show that I am that same wall. The truth is so. And this the cranny is, bright and sinister, through which the fearful lovers are to whisper.
Would you desire a lime and hair to speak better?
It is the wittiest partition that ever I heard discourse of. Oh.
Pyramus draws near the wall. Silence.
You so black, oh night, which ever out when day is not. Oh night, alack, alack, alack! I fear my Thisbe's promise is forgot. And thou, oh wall, oh sweet, oh lovely wall that stands between her father's ground and mine, thou wall, oh sweet, oh lovely wall. Show me thy chink to blink through with mine eye.
Thanks, courteous boss. Go before
But what's the eye? No Thisbe do I see. Oh, wicked wall, through whom I see no bliss. Cursed be thy stones for thus deceiving me.
The wall, methinks, being sensible, should curse again.
No, in truth, sir, he should not.
deceiving me is Thisbe's cue. She is to enter now, and I am to spy her through the wall. You shall see it will fall out as I told you. Yonder she comes. I see a voice. Now will I to the chink to spy, and I can hear my Thisbe's face. Thisbe!
My love! Thank my love, I think.
Think what thou wilt, I am thy lover's grace. And like Lymander, I am trusty still.
And I, like Helen, shall face me kill.
Oh, kiss me through the hole of this vile wall! Out Minnie's tomb, meet me straight away.
Shine, I come without delay.
Thus have I wall my part discharged so, and being done, thus wall away doth go.
Now is the mural down between these two neighbors.
No remedy, my lord, when walls are so willful to you without warning.
That's the silliest stuff that ever I heard.
But the best in this kind are but shadows, and the worst are no worse if, you know, we amend them.
Must be your imagination, then, and not theirs.
If we imagine no worse of them than they of themselves, they may pass for excellent men. Here comes two noble beasts in, a moon and a lion.
You, ladies, you, whose gentle hearts do fear, the smallest monstrous mouse that crawls on ground may now perchance both quake and tremble here when lion, wild in roughest rage, doth roar. Then know that I, one snug the joiner, am. A lion fell, nor else no lion's dam. For if I should this lion come in strife into this place, for pity on my life.
A very gentle beast, and of a good conscience.
The very best set of beasts, my lord, that ever I saw.
Let us listen to the moon.
This lanthorn doth the horned moon present.
He should have worn the horns on his head.
He is no crescent, and his horns are invisible in the circumference.
This lanthorn doth the horned moon present. Myself, the man in the moon, do seem to be.
This is the greatest error of all the rest. The man should be put into the lantern. How is it else the man in the moon?
I am aweary of this moon. Would he would change.
Proceed, moon.
All that I have to say is to tell you that the lantern is the moon, I the man in the moon, this thorn bush my thorn bush, and this dog my dog.
Why? All these should be in the lantern, for all these are in the moon.
But silence! Here comes Thisbe.
Yes, it's old Minnie's too. Where is my love? Oh, a roar!
A roar, man!
Well run, Thisbe!
Well shown, moon. Truly the moon shines.
Well mouse, lion!
So comes Pyramus.
And then the lion vanishes.
Sweet moon, I thank thee for thy sunny beams. I thank thee, moon, that shines now so bright. For by thy gracious golden glittering stream, I trust to take of truest Thisbe's sight. But stay, oh spite, but mark, poor knight, what dreadful dole is here. Eyes, do you see? How can it be? Oh, dainty duck, oh dear! Thy mantle good, what stained with blood? Approach, ye furies foul! Oh, fates, come, cut thread and thrum! Quell, crush, conclude, and quell!
This passion and the death of a dear friend would go near to make a man look sad!
Wherefore, nature, didst thou lion's frame? Since lion vile hath here deflowered, my dear, which is... No, which was their shame, that lives, that loves, that lights, that looked with cheer. Come, tears confound, and sword and wound that path of Pyramus, aye, that left path where heart doth hop, and thus die I, thus. Now am I death, now am I flesh, my soul is in the sky. Tongue, lose thy light, moon, take thy flight. Now die.
Go die, but an ace for him, for he's but one!
That's not an ace, man, for he is dead, he is nothing!
With the help of a surgeon, he might yet recover and prove an ass!
How can Moonshine has gone before Gisby comes back and finds her lover?
She will find him by starlight!
Oh.
Here she comes, and her passion ends the play.
Methinks she should not use a long one for such a pyramid. I hope she will be.
She hath already spied it with those sweet eyes.
Oh, sweet. My love. What? Dead. My job. Oh, Pyramus. Arise. Speak, sweet. My job. Dead. Dead. You must cover thy sweet eyes, these lily lips, this cherry nose, these yellow, rosy cheeks are gone.
Lovers make moan. His eyes were green as leaves. Tongue, not a word. Come, trusty sword, come blade my breast and brew, and farewell, friends, thus this be end. Adieu.
Moonshine and Lion are left to bury the dead.
Lion Wall, too. No, I assure you, the wall is down that parted their fathers. Will it please you to see the epilogue?
No! Epilogue, I pray you! Your play needs no excuse!
Never excuse, for when the players are all dead, there need none to be blamed! Let your epilogue alone!
The iron tongue of midnight hath told 12!
Lovers, to bed! Tis almost fairy time! Till the break of day, through this house each fairy strength. To the best bright bed will we, which by us shall blessed be. And the issue there create, ever shall be fortunate. So shall all the couples three ever true and loving be. And the blots of nature's hands shall not in their issue stand. Never mole, hair lip, nor scar, nor mark prodigious, such as our despised nativity, shall upon their children be. With this field to consecrate, every fairy take his gate, and each several chambers bless through this palace with sweet peace. Air shall it in safety rest, and the owner of it blessed. Trip away, make no stay, meet me all by break of day.
If we shadows have offended, think with this, and all is mended, that you have but slumbered here while these visions did appear, and this weak and idle being no more yielding but to dream. Gentles, do not reprehend. If you pardon, we will mend. And as I am an honest puck, if we have unearned luck to skip the serpent's tongue, we shall make amends ere long. Else the puck a liar call. And so, good night unto you all. Give me your hands if we be friends, and Robin shall restore amends.
Thank you.